One of the things that I have discovered about myself over time is that I am a much more shallow person than I would like to admit. And what I mean by shallow is maybe selfish. I do things or withhold myself from doing things based on what's in it for me. What is the reward for myself? Now, for a long time, I tried to deny that, and I wanted to be a person who just did the right thing because it's right, and I don't do the wrong thing because it's wrong. But I found that I failed over and over. But there's good news if you find yourself in a similar situation as me. What I have come to discover over time is that God is a rewarder of those who seek after Him, who follow His ways. And for a long time, I thought that reward was just heaven. Someday, you know, we're gonna hit the jackpot. It's gonna be big. But right now, it's just gonna suck. And you're just gonna have to suck it up, and that's just the way it is. But what the Lord has shown me is that the Lord blesses me so much right now in this life when I follow Him and I follow His ways that even if heaven were not real, I stand here today and I would say it is worth it. Because I've followed both paths and I continue to follow both paths. And sometimes the enemy paints something and it looks good. And even though I've been bit every time, I still go for it and then I get bit. But when I follow God and I follow His ways, what I find is that I am constantly rewarded. Now, does that mean that life's not difficult? Nope. Life is difficult whether you follow the Lord or not. It is. This world is cursed. Our flesh is cursed. And life is difficult. But I have a choice. My choice is that if I trust in the Lord and I follow His ways, I will be rewarded here and now in ways that make it worth it. If I follow the enemy, I will be duped every time. And when I follow the enemy and I receive a little something, well, that little something isn't going to be good enough the next time. And I'm going to need more of that something and more of that something. And the thing is that I find is that the consequences that come along with the so-called fake rewards that He gives far outweigh the reward. And it stinks. But for the longest time, I thought that, you know, with that kind of mindset, I'm just not worthy to follow the Lord. But I want to say to you this morning that Scripture instructs us that we are to look for the rewards. Now you might say, what? No way! Because oftentimes the picture that we are given by righteous people is, no, you do it because it's the right thing to do. You know, you hear statements like, character is, you know, what you do when nobody's watching. Well, you know what I found? I found that if I think that nobody's watching, I will do whatever I think I can get away with. That's what I found about myself. And I found that most people are like that. I've shared this with you before, but it doesn't stop getting me. I mean, when I make a traffic stop, every time somebody lies to me, every time, and I know it. And it's just like, why? Because it is so ingrained in us. If we think we can get away with it, we will. And every time I get frustrated, the Lord reminds me, you're the same way. But here's what I found. What I found is there is no such thing as nobody is watching you. No such thing. Because there is nowhere that you can go that the Lord does not see you. Amen. And when you do what He says, even if no other person sees it, the Lord rewards you. And Scripture testifies to that, and we're going to look at that today. So if you open a door for somebody and they don't say thank you, that burns me. I just want to lift my foot up right after I, that burns me. I'm like, are you kidding me? Or was that your right that I was, am I your sir? But you know what? The Lord sees it. And the Lord rewards. Because I find that if I walk around with a cold heart that tries to protect myself, as Stephanie was praying about earlier, I find that I walk around miserable. But I find that when I open up my heart and I love people, no matter what their response is, I find that God finds ways to bless me and to fill my heart. I want to look at a scripture this morning that's not our main text. It's the same chapter, though, Hebrews 11. Matt, if you'd bring up verse 6 before we go to the main text this morning, I want you to hear this. Chapter 11 of Hebrews is the faith chapter. It's all about faith. And in verse 6 it says, it is impossible to please God without faith. Now it's going to talk about what faith is. Anyone who wants to come to Him must believe that God exists and that He rewards those who sincerely seek Him. This is the difference between the one who is following God and the one who is not. James says, demons believe and shudder. If you are a believer in Jesus and you're sitting in a church today, that doesn't mean squat. You could be a demon. Because demons believe and they even shudder at Him. So what is the difference? Well, the difference is the demons don't believe following Him is worth it. They believe there's a better way, and that if they go against Him, the reward is going to be better. And that's what you've got to decide. You know, we live in this culture of, oh, if you believe in Jesus, you're going to heaven. Baloney. James says it. Demons believe they are not going to heaven. Belief does not cut it. What does cut it? What cuts it is, do you believe He will reward you, that it is worth following Him? And your life answers the question, not your mouth, your life. If you are following Him, then your life says, yes, you believe it's worth it. And even when you're going through some struggles and it's feeling like, I don't know, right now this doesn't feel worth it, and you stick with it, and then the reward comes, that's when your life testifies that you believe He is a rewarder. So if you've bought in the baloney that to follow God, you're just going to get a reward in heaven, there's nothing here, and that you need to be a person that just does it because it's the right thing to do, well, God bless you, I can't do it. I've discovered that about myself. But here's the beauty I've found, is that when I trust Him and when I follow Him, He rewards me. Now, is it always immediate? Absolutely not. I've found the good things in life take a while to happen. And it takes walking in the same direction for a while before the rewards really start to come in. You know, the things that are really worth it in life, I mean, they take some time. That's what I've found. And praise the Lord, He sends His Holy Spirit to fill us and to walk us through that. And He does give us some rewards along the way. But it's a matter of trusting Him. And so it's not like rubbing a genie, you know, and all of a sudden, boom, God just gives us the rewards. No, it's not like that. But He rewards us. I want to look at one example in Scripture. It's going to be in Hebrews 11, and it's going to be talking about Moses. This is one example. That whole chapter is full of examples. The Bible is full of examples. We're going to look at that. We're going to talk about that. And then we're also going to look at other Scriptures that talk about, here's ways that you can be rewarded. Scripture just says it. You do this, God rewards you. And I also want to remind you before we go to this text that just a few weeks ago, we read a scripture in Matthew, and Peter was like, God or Jesus, we've given up, you know, all this stuff for you. What's in it for us? And Jesus clearly said that you will be rewarded greatly in this life and the one to come. Amen. It is not just the one to come. I want you to hear that. That is so important, because if it were just the one to come, I'll be honest with you, I don't know if I could do it. I need rewards. I've found that I do, and praise God that when I've accepted that, I've found He comes through. Hebrews chapter 11, I want to begin in verse 24. It was by faith that Moses, when he grew up, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He chose to share the oppression of God's people instead of enjoying the fleeting pleasures of sin. Now, I want you to hear this. The rewards that Moses was going to receive in this life, again, he didn't receive it just boom like that. No, it took a little time, and he had to say no to some other things. But ultimately, he was rewarded in a great way. Moses could have taken the path, and if God had said, take this path, it would have been okay, but this is not what God said. Moses could have taken the path of being called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, which would have meant he would have had unspeakable wealth during that time. He would have had all the comforts that the world had to offer during that time. But what would have been the payback? What would he... Even though he has all these comforts, what he would have missed out on is being face to face with God. He would have missed out on all the miracles of seeing God move, of being used by God to bless other people. He would have bypassed all that. And you know what I've found? We live in such a comfortable culture. I mean, think of all the comforts we have. I have found that if I am not in a good place with the Lord and I'm being selfish, those comforts no longer make me happy. I am miserable. I can be sitting on a comfortable couch in the air conditioning or heat, whatever it is, nice comfy temperature, watching, you know, my favorite show, eating my favorite foods, and I am miserable. Because I've found that I need certain challenges in my life. I need challenges where I see God come through and God helps me to overcome. I don't want that constantly. Sometimes I need some rest. But I find if I rest 24/7, I'm miserable. I want to go do something. Do you hear what I'm saying? Sometimes I enjoy comfort. I do. But I find if that's all I have, I become miserable in it. That's what I've discovered. And so Moses, when you think about what he was giving up, it was worth it. Because he was giving up a life without God. Because that culture there, they didn't know God. And God was calling him to a different path. Well, Moses believed and trusted God. And here's the thing. It said he had faith. And earlier it says that faith is believing God rewards those who seek Him. So Moses had faith that God would reward him if he said no to what was looking really good in that moment. And for a while, you know what? It was tough for Moses. Because if you don't know the story of Moses, Moses had to leave Egypt. He had to go live 40 years, okay, as a shepherd. And so it wasn't looking good for him. But you know what? At the end of that, he comes back and he is God's chosen vessel. He is able to speak directly with God like no one else on earth at that time. He is able to see God move in ways that no one else is able to see. And then he is able to be the spokesman for God to the most powerful nation in the world at that time and to bring plagues against them and to deliver God's people, to be a vessel of God's love for His people. Now, let me ask you, would you be willing to give up a little comfort for that? I would. And again, I'm a pretty shallow person. But when I look at both of them, I'm like, okay, comfort, except there's no adventure, no love. I feel sick to my soul, and you know, I probably have to keep doing more and more drugs or something to help the days pass so I don't go insane. That just doesn't sound good. Or I get to go through some hard times, okay? But you know what? I've found, and I've shared this with you before, some of my most happiest times are not when I'm in the middle of some kind of comfortable setting. It's actually when I'm being challenged many times, or I'm out in God's creation, and there's some challenge to that. But I get to see His beauty, and I get to be in His presence, and I've found it's worth it. And that's what Moses chose. It goes on. Verse 26, he thought it was better to suffer for the sake of Christ than to own the treasures of Egypt, for he was looking ahead to his great reward. So once again, there's a time there, okay? It's not immediate. He's having to look ahead. And of course, he's also, this is also talking about his inheritance that he will have for eternity. But it doesn't just start in heaven. He was going to have rewards here on this earth. Verse 27, it was by faith that Moses left the land of Egypt, not fearing the king's anger. Now I want you to think about that reward right there. He did not fear the king's anger. What if you did not have to fear authority or anyone that would come against you? Do you have fear? Do you fear people over you at work? Do you fear people in authority? Do you just live in a general place of fear? Well, you know what? When you say yes to the Lord and you believe that He is a rewarder of those who seek Him and who listen to Him and follow after Him, you don't have to fear. Why? Because you get to see Him move on your behalf. And as you begin to see Him move on your behalf, here's what happened. Your faith grows. You've probably heard the example, faith is like a muscle, you know, you work it out and it grows. And there's truth to that because I've found that. Because, you know, you reach this place where life is stinking for you. And you're kind of like, well, you know, I've been doing this my way, and man, if this is how life is going to be, I really don't want all my days to be like this. I'm hearing people say that following God and following His ways is something better. I don't know for sure, but, you know, this other is so bad, I think I'm just going to give it a try. I'm going to give it a try in this area. That's what I've done in my life. And what I've found is I've been blessed. And so it's kind of like, well, that did go pretty well. Maybe I'll trust Him with this area of my life. Okay, well then He blesses in that area, and then He blesses in that area. And all of a sudden it's like, man, this is actually worth it. But hear this, you will never know that unless you start taking some steps that the Lord is telling you right now. I can sit up here and I can tell you stories from my short little life that aren't nearly as long as the years Matt has been living. But even then, that's not good enough. You've got to do it on your own. You can read this Bible and all the stories. It's not good enough. You must see it on your own. And the only way it will happen is when you step out and you do something that God is asking you to do that you don't want to do. But you say, all right, I'm going to do this. And here's what I found about the grace and mercy of God. When you're just beginning, God is quick to reward because He wants to show you can trust me. Now, as you grow in Him, I find that sometimes it takes a little longer because He's stretching your faith and it's for the good. He wants you to trust Him no matter what is standing in front of you, no matter what the enemy is speaking to you, no matter what the situation appears to be. He wants you to trust Him because you live life through spiritual eyes. I don't know where you're at right now, okay? Maybe you're just beginning this journey. I want to say to you, take some steps. The Lord's going to bless you, and I believe quickly. But for some of you, you've seen some of that. And now you're in a place where it's taking a little longer. And you know what? You're starting to doubt. And that's okay. That's our flesh. I just want to encourage you to keep going. Because what I've also found is that the rewards that take longer are far better than the ones that come quickly. Amen. Far better. Keep moving. He kept right on going because he kept his eyes on the one who is invisible. You see, that's where faith takes us. Why didn't he fear the king? Because his eyes were on Jesus, the one that was invisible to so many. But because he kept his eyes on that one, the things that were visible to the physical eye, he wasn't fearing. But again, to get to that point, you've got to start taking some small steps. And you got to keep moving in that direction. It never stops. There's never a point that you reach that the Lord says, okay, you and I are good, no more steps of faith. No, as long as you live, there are more steps of faith. And if you're not taking steps of faith, what you're doing is saying, I don't trust you, Lord. And at that point, what you're saying is, I trust the enemy more. And you're getting pulled back. There's no hanging out, okay? There are certainly seasons in our life, but there is a continual place that the Lord is asking us to move forward. Verse 28, it was by faith that Moses commanded the people of Israel to keep the Passover and to sprinkle blood on the doorposts so that the angel of death would not kill their firstborn sons. It was by faith that the people of Israel went right through the Red Sea as though they were on dry ground. But when the Egyptians tried to follow, they were all drowned. Now, a couple things I want to say about that. You know, we read about these things and we celebrate them and, oh man, that's so awesome. But you know what? Nothing like that had happened prior to this. Moses simply had to trust God. God works in such unique ways that sometimes the things that he is asking you to do and to trust him for, you've never seen it and no one around you has ever seen it. And it seems crazy. Think about it. What Moses is being asked to do, it's insane. And it's never been seen. But in order to see and to be rewarded, Moses has to trust him. I mean, to sprinkle the doorposts and to believe they're going to be saved, it sounds ridiculous. But now we celebrate it. To part the Red Sea, okay, again, he fled Egypt. Egypt's army is coming after him. They're much bigger, stronger, faster. They've got nowhere to go. There's the sea. They're going to be trampled. But then at the last minute, God parts it and he gives them a victory. Do you know what it is to be up against a wall where you think you're going to lose and to see God come through? Not unless you have faith and you take some crazy steps that he's asking you to. So here's the question. Where is the Lord asking you right now to step out? He's asking you at some place in your life. There are things that you're just not quite comfortable with that he's asking you to trust him. Where is that at? Now, what I want to tell you is that not only is trusting him the right thing to do, but if you do it, he's going to reward you. How is he going to reward you? I don't know. He works so uniquely, but you're going to get to see a move of God somehow that you don't expect. Now, here's the other part of it. If you say no, you don't get to see it. Now, God is patient, and he will be there for you, and you may have to go through 5, 10, 20, whatever years of suffering and misery because you're just rebelling against him and whatever, and he's going to be there, okay? He's patient. But you don't have to go through that. How many things could I miss out on when I think about my future and however many days I have on this earth? When I think about, man, I don't want to miss out on blessings that the Lord wants to give me because I didn't trust him. I want to say yes to him, even though they sound crazy. Now, here's the other thing. Scripture also talks about this, that when we do those things, God is going to bless us more and more. Scripture says things like, if he can trust you with a little, God's going to give you more, okay? It talks about that. Now, some of us think, well, you know what? I really don't want more because that sounds like more responsibility. But you know what? That's not how it works. Because when God works through you, it's him working. You just get to see the product of it. It's just a matter of you saying yes to him. So when God can trust you in the little things and you begin to say yes to him in little things, what he's going to do is he's going to allow you to see greater and greater harvests because he's going to entrust you with more and more things. And again, that doesn't mean that you're going to feel all this extra pressure and all that. No, God's still the one working, but you get to see the fruit when we say yes. Now, I want to share just some scriptures that talk about different rewards that we can receive. Luke 14:12 says, invite those over that can't invite you back. Invite those over who can't invite you back. See, when you invite someone over to your house that is eventually going to just invite you back over and bless you just as much as they blessed you, that's a blessing, okay? And there's nothing wrong with that. But Scripture says, when you invite people over and you bless them, people who can't bless you back in the same way, God is going to step in and he's going to bless you. Remember that. Let that motivate you. Be shallow like me. Look to the reward. You'll be amazed at what you might start doing. Matthew 5:6, what reward is there for loving those who love you? That's what everybody does. But you know what? When you love people who don't love you back, when you open the door for that whatever, who doesn't say thank you, you're loving people who don't love you back. And you know what? God's going to step into that and he's going to bless you. But you know what? When you love people and then they love you back, that's a blessing. But you know what? God's not going to step into that. Matthew 6:1 says, we'll lose the reward when we do deeds in front of others. All right, so when we do something that blesses somebody and we're doing it for everybody to see, that's the reward you get. Others saw it and they're like, oh, you're so great. Okay. Well, if you do it so that nobody sees it, guess what? God is going to step in and he's going to bless you. That's a promise of Scripture. Matthew 10:41 says that when we are kind to a prophet or a righteous person, we receive the rewards that come to the prophet or righteous person. 1 Corinthians 3:8 says there's a reward for those who plant and for those who water. 4:17, there's a reward for giving. First Timothy 3:13, those who serve within the church, talks about rewarded with respect. And Hebrews 11:26 that we looked at, there's a reward of seeing God move. That's not a comprehensive list. That's just some things I'm throwing out. But what I'm saying is that when we trust God, and we trust his ways, and we do things that he's motivating us to do. You know, maybe you're thinking of doing something to bless somebody, and you're honestly thinking in your head, well, I'm not going to see anything back from that. Well, you know what? That means God's going to step in and bless you. So let that motivate you. Do you hear what I'm saying? And you amaze yourself, oh, that's so shallow of me. Well, that's how God works. And I've found that it motivates me to do more and more and to trust him in greater ways. Now, again, does it mean your life is going to be smooth? No. Scripture says you're going to be persecuted. That's what it says. But think about Jesus for a minute, okay? Jesus trusted God fully. And what was Jesus' life like? Well, he had some people who followed him through thick and thin. Now, one of his close people ended up betraying him. Okay, so he went through some heartache there. He was eventually hung from a cross and people hated him. But in the midst of it, what did he get to see? he got to see God move in ways that no other had. And imagine the, think about this for a second. Think about the people that he healed, okay, that God healed through him, and think about the love and what must have come through those people that he healed. What if God wanted to use you in that way? What would you be willing to give up? Crystal shared the scripture about, you know, the hidden pearl and selling everything for it. I mean, this is selfish here, but I've seen God move in some ways, and I've found it's worth any kind of earthly inheritance I could build up. I mean, it's just, and I'm not saying that to sound righteous, I've just found it's awesome. I mean, when you are used of God, and then you see someone look at you like, thank you, my life will never be the same, I'm telling you, it's worth it. It is so worth it. It's not a righteous thing. It's just flat out worth it. God wants to work through you. God wants to work through the church in greater ways than he worked through Jesus individually. And he wants you to be part of that. But in order to be part of that, it means saying yes right now to some things that you don't think you can say yes to, but you can. And God's going to reward you, and then he's going to take you deeper, and it's going to get better, and it's going to get better. Life is difficult no matter where you live. I was thinking about this week. I was trying to think of one person that I would trade my life with if I could. And I got to be straight up with you. I can't think of a single person I know that I would trade my life with. Now, there are certainly things that I would say, oh, I wish this was different. I wish this was different. All of us would do that. But you know what? I have been so blessed that I can't think of another person that I actually know that I would say, I want to trade my life with them because I am so blessed. I mean, do I have everything that the world has to offer? No. But I've had enough of a taste of things to know that's just not really what I want. Trust him. He wants to bless you. He wants to reward you, but it takes trusting him. Jesus, thank you that we don't have to wait till the end to be blessed by you. Thank you, Lord, that you want to bless us now. But thank you that you don't just pour them out, Lord, because I know what my flesh would do with them. It would ruin them. Thank you, Lord, that you know where we're at and what we can handle. But give us the faith, Holy Spirit, to keep moving forward, to trust in you with what you're asking of us right now. Lord, we want to be the hands and feet of Jesus. We want to see you move in powerful ways. Lord, I want to see you move the way that Moses did. I want to see people blessed the way that Jesus did, and to see the love in their eyes and the gratefulness, knowing that we are just instruments of you, who are able to pass that along to others. Lord, give us the faith to believe. In Jesus' name, amen. If you would